with my shepherd.
Thank you, Saran, for your dance and creative expression and facilitating an opening for us to have a spiritual and ritual experience this evening. We appreciate you. Greetings, brothers and sisters and family and friends. It's an honor to share this virtual space with you at this time as the Holy Order of the Maccabees present our annual ritual observance for Hanukkah. Let us extend our hands for a prayer of invocation. Almighty God, the source and substance of all existence, we give thanks, Almighty God, for the grace continue to be shown to us, for your incessant presence and love that flows and vibrates throughout our bodies and ourselves. We pray that this ritual, Almighty God, ignite a flame in our hearts and influence the world around us. We call out to the ancestors that their field of influence guide us as we continue to struggle for the redemption and liberation of African people across the world. We pray this and other prayers in Jesus, our spiritual guide and revolutionary example. Amen and Ashe.
Hanukkah, also known as the Feast of Dedication or the Festival of Lights, is an 8-day celebration commemorating the renewal and rededication of the Holy Temple in Jerusalem back to the God of Israel after a 3-year period of foreign worship and domination. In 167 BC, under the reign of the infamous king Antiochus Epiphanes, a decree was issued to the Israelites, forcing them to abandon their covenant with God, to cease all religious and cultural observances that identified them as a people of God, and then forced them to adopt the foreign gods of their Greek oppressors. Refusal meant a gruesome and torturous death.
While some chose to accept foreign idols out of a desire to become modern and being accepted amongst the nations, others chose to go along out of fear. Yet, there were others who refused to abandon the gods of their ancestors. However, they would not defend themselves either, so they were killed as martyrs. The Israelites was faced with culture and physical annihilation, just as the lost tribes of Israel faced centuries earlier.
And then arose a priest named Mattathias and his 5 sons, who became known as the Maccabees, the hammers of God. They would neither give up their God or their lives without a fight. And so they fought with the blessings of God and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. They declared a war against the Syrian Empire. While their enemies put their faith in their superior capabilities, experience, and the equipment of their army, the Maccabees put their faith in God and were victorious. After 3 years of fighting, they recaptured the Holy Temple and restored its worship to the God of Israel in 164 BC. And so Hanukkah celebrates the intervention of God through the victory of the Maccabees in one of the darkest periods in the history of ancient Israel.
However, the story doesn't end there. According to legend, during the cleansing of the temple, the Maccabees could only find enough oil to light the menorah for one day. Rather than wait for new oil to be pressed, the Maccabees lit the supply they had, and miraculously, the one-day supply of oil lasted for 8 days. This miracle was seen as confirmation by the Holy Spirit that their victory on the battlefield was indeed a miracle orchestrated by God, and not the mere might of men or their tactical ingenuity.
Hence, the celebration of Hanukkah is not just a celebration of military victory won by the Maccabees, which itself is significant. More importantly, it is a celebration of God's intervention on behalf of the downtrodden and oppressed. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, God kept the covenant promise to protect and provide for the people of faith.
During the season of Advent, we celebrate and anticipate the triumph of God's intervention through the expected arrival of the Messiah, a time when the light of God overcomes the spirit of darkness in the world. Hanukkah affirms this triumph by reminding us that God, the source of all light, is capable of overcoming darkness, as seen through the victory of the Maccabees and the miracle of the oil. God is indeed the ultimate force multiplier, able to create abundance from meager resources. So with faith, if we are willing to take the first step, dedicating all that we are and all that we have, however much or however little we may feel that may be, God can make up the difference. Amen and I say.
Lighting the Hanukkah menorah. The Hanukkah menorah is a 9-branch candelabrum which holds one candle for each day of Hanukkah and an additional candle used solely to light the others. This additional candle is called the shamash. The shamash is usually placed in the center or the end of the menorah. For our observance, we place it in the center, not only to symbolize the light and power of God, but also our desire to place God at the center of our lives. The candles are placed on the menorah from right to left. One candle is added each day. This symbolizes the light and power of God, gradually overcoming the spirit of darkness in the world, as well as our desire to increase the influence of God's light and power in our daily walk. Once the appropriate number of candles have been placed in the menorah, the candles are lit from left to right, starting with the newest candle first. This symbolizes the newness of life and the new opportunities that arise daily to let our light shine. New opportunities that are born from the light of God's grace and mercy.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. We come now to the lighting of the menorah. Before we light the candles, let's review the symbols of Hanukkah. The menorah is a 9-branch candelabrum used to represent the 8 days of the miracle of oil. It symbolizes the presence and eternal light of God. The 9th candle is called the shamash, which means servant. This candle is used to light all the other candles. It symbolizes the importance and necessity to be of service to one another. And finally, we have the oil, which symbolizes the purity and spirit of God. Tonight is the second night of Hanukkah, so we'll be lighting 2 candles. Let the congregation repeat after me. We light this candle to symbolize God's light, God's power, and God's presence in this place. Let the congregation repeat after me. We light these candles to symbolize God's light, God's power, and God's presence within each of us. In traditional African society, we pour libation into the earth to commemorate and honor the life of our ancestors. During Hanukkah, we pay homage to those brothers and sisters who sacrificed to protect and serve the nation. We call on the names of Jeremoji Ababi Ajiman, General Masai, Major Aswadi, Major Kokai, Major Makanda, Corporal Nanyanka, Private Ayinka, and all those brothers and sisters who have joined the ranks of our ancestors, Ashe. Call out the names of those brothers and sisters in your family who have taken their place in the ancestral realm. Ashe, Ashe, Asheo. Now, let us pray. Praise be to you, O God, source of all light. Hallowed be thy holy name. We acknowledge and give thanks to you, O God, for it is through the power of thy divine light that our ancestors were empowered to fight against the darkness of their oppression. We come seeking, O God, that we too may be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray for thy divine light to shine through us, that we may offer guidance and protection for our people in a world full of darkness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and Ashe.
The soul of everyone. can be found. An anchor or a rock to lean on, a captain to take us through the storm. What makes a soldier ride alone into battle? Can anybody tell me where he's coming from? He's that stranger on the street. Child is at your feet, searching for freedom and justice for all. We've seen them time and again. You know they only fight to win. They're the challengers of evil, and I'm glad we know them. Heroes make the sunrise. Morning. Heroes make the moon shine bright at night. Heroes make our lives a little stronger. All our fears go away when he's round.
Sisters, today we're going to do a little word on Hanukkah. Of course, we're in the season of Advent and Christmas, but Hanukkah is a big part of that for our church and for our history. But before we can actually deal with Hanukkah, certainly we got to look at the Maccabees. And before we can really deal with the Maccabees, we have to look at the covenant, because everything kind of grew out of that covenant faith. The common thread that runs through the Maccabees, through Hanukkah, through Advent, Christmas, is the covenant. Remove the covenant, and this history might not happen, or would have definitely been different than it actually turned out to be. When we talk about the covenant, we look back to the book of Genesis, chapter 17, where God encounters Abraham and actually makes a covenant, agreeing that if Abraham would be the recipient of this covenant, that God would make him a great nation, and that nation in itself would be the people of God. So the covenant required that we be a people of God, that God said that I will be your God and then you would be my people. This lends itself to the basic fact that God is cosmic energy and creative intelligence. God is not some big man on a cloud, black or white. The premise is that God is the source and substance of all creation. A disembodied God needs a people to act through. So the covenant is a part of that agreement. I will be your God and you will be my people. And the Bible basically plays out that way, where you see the black nation Israel going through change after change, actually trying to figure out how to be the people of God. When they got it right, they lived well and they were victorious. When they got it wrong, they had all kind of issues and troubles. But as we look at the book of Maccabees, these books will not be found in the King James Version of your Bible, which is used by 99.9% of the black population. That is, those who do use the Bible at all. But these books are considered apocryphal and historically fall between the Old and the New Testaments, which has appeared in history around 333 B.C. and 134 B.C. If you look at history, some people try to separate the Old Testament from the New Testament. I even heard a man on YouTube the other day talking about the God of the Old Testament and then the God of the New Testament as if it was two separate gods. The only difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament is how we look at it, how we deal with it. But the covenant is a common thread between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And we see that even when we look at Jesus. Jesus was saying that I didn't come to abolish the covenant of the law, I came to fulfill it. But when we look at the Maccabees, these two books are basically very important to the history of the black nation Israel, simply because they highlight a time when the nation Israel was overrun by the Greeks. The Greeks invaded Palestine, and the two books basically outline this invasion. They outline a vicious oppression, a vicious oppressor. And, you know, historically, they try to paint the Greeks as some purveyors of culture, and that wasn't the case at all. The Greeks only brought death and destruction and decadence to the black nation Israel. These two books outlines that history and that oppression. It outlines the struggle for freedom. The books highlight the commitment of one family, the Maccabees, who remained loyal to the covenant and the law of God and fought against oppression. That's the history that basically that they've eliminated from our past because of the books that we read. The King James Version of the Bible doesn't have these stories. That further illustrates the simple fact that the Bible was not written by the hand of God. The Bible was assembled over a period of time, and some books were left out of the Bible. That's why we need to look at the Maccabees, and simply because fighting against oppression an oppressor, that's important for us who are today oppressed. And so when we look at these books, we can glean these messages from it that God is against oppression. And when a people have covenant with God, who have entered this covenant relationship, when we do what we can to maintain the covenant, then God fights with us as we struggle against our oppression. That's very important when we look at our history, when we look at the history of the black nation of Israel. So when we look at Hanukkah, we have to understand the significance of this celebration, simply because it talks about a struggle for liberation and actually overcoming odds that would seem insurmountable to liberate a people. But the fact of Hanukkah, it's a story. One of the chapters of the history of the Maccabees, it's a story of one of their most significant achievements. Quite simply, after 3 years of fighting against a stronger and more experienced enemy, the Maccabees succeeded in recapturing the temple at Jerusalem, which was the center of their religious worship and their belief in God. And so to recapture the temple was a very important period in their life. And so the story goes that once they recaptured the temple, they had to go about the process of purifying the temple because of the vile Greeks who had inhabited and polluted the temple with their religious rites and observances. And so in their efforts to purify the temple, the theory is that there was only enough oil to last for one day. But mysteriously, miraculously, a simple miracle, oil lasted for 8 days. And so once they finished cleaning and purifying the temple, they actually went about the establishment of the worship and decided that these 8 days of would be called Hanukkah and would be celebrated and have been celebrated for the last 2,200 years. So we're looking at history when we look at Hanukkah. We're looking at a people who've struggled against an oppressor and overcame that oppression. And that's important because from the time that the Greeks invaded Palestine to the time of the Maccabean revolt was around 160 years. Now you got to understand that you've been under the oppression of another people for 160 years. Most people have basically given in or given up and decided to actually try to integrate with the Greeks or become a little Greek or accept Greeks' habits and rituals, and they were employed by the Greeks. But the Maccabees weren't having that kind of separation from God. They believed in the covenant and the law of God, and they believed in their religious practices and their religious principles, and they followed that to the letter of the law. It's required them to resist their oppression, fight against their oppression in order to maintain who they were. And so when we look at the history of the Black Nation of Israel right up to the advent of Jesus, we realize that between the time of the Maccabean revolt and the time that Jesus launched his ministry, it was around 160 years. So again, we look at an oppressor at this point in the history of the Black Nation of Israel, but these are now the Romans. But 160 years later, Jesus launches a struggle for the liberation of the Black Nation of Israel. When he announced his ministry, he simply said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. That's important because he wasn't coming to bring peace. He was coming to actually try to organize a struggle for the liberation of a people. And so that was important. The nation Israel, Jesus, all were connected to their history. They understood that they were an oppressed people. They were not under any illusions about who they were and who the enemy was. So they struggled against that oppression, and that's the gift that we receive as a part of this ministry, a part of this fellowship, as a part of the Holy Order of the Maccabees, as servants of God. We believe that God will intervene in our history on our behalf when we show our commitment to the covenant and the law of God. When we commit ourselves to a struggle for liberation, we do believe that the power of God is made available to us, and we can overcome insurmountable odds. We can overcome our enemies. We can actually build a world that's committed to God, that serves God, and actually serves the people of God. So we continue this struggle. We continue this effort to commit ourselves to the covenant and the law of God. And that in itself gives us hope. That gives us faith. That gives us the desire and the strength to love one another because we know that it's necessary in order for us to be the people of God.
We want to thank Walamoyirungu for the message tonight, reminding us of the importance of the covenant and God's promise to intervene on our behalf when we shape up and show up to the fight. Victory is not going to just fall in our lap. We got to do the work. There's just no getting around that. Now, with that said, this concludes tonight's observance. We hope that you get something out of it. Maybe you learned something you didn't previously know, or you were reminded of something you may have forgotten. Perhaps you're curious about the Maccabees and want to know more about them and their impact on the lives of ancient Israel and even in the ministry of Jesus. If so, you can join us next Wednesday, 16 December at 7 p.m. where we will talk more in depth about the legacy of the Maccabees. You can also find out more in your Hanukkah activity guide that was sent out. With that said, we bid you all a farewell and good night, and we hope that you are taking the necessary precautions and preparations to stay safe and secure during these turbulent times. We want to continue to hope, pray, and work for the best, but we must always be prepared for the worst. With that, amen, and we'll now have the prayer of benediction.
Let's stand our hands for a prayer of benediction. Almighty God, we give thanks for this time we shared this evening with our ritual of light, that we ourselves be the light that and the force to bring change and transformation to African people across the world. We pray, Almighty God, that your love and Holy Spirit last beyond the night, that we can continue to serve thee and serve others and continue to work for power and liberation. We pray these and other prayers in Jesus, our revolutionary example and spiritual guide. Amen.